Good morning, PCC. Was that not a wonderful song for us to start with today? How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. This is truly a praise song for our Lord, and I found another psalm I'd like to read with you today. It's Psalm number 93, and if you'd like to get there quick, you can follow along, but the psalmist writes these words, "The Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed. He has put on his strength as a belt. Yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved. Your throne is established from of old. You are from everlasting. The floods have lifted up, O Lord. The floods have lifted up their voice. The floods lift up their roaring. Mightier than the thunders of many waters, mightier than the waves of the sea, the Lord on high is mighty. Your decrees are very trustworthy. Holiness befits your house, O Lord, forevermore." Did you notice the first phrase and the very last phrase of this psalm? The Lord reigns forevermore. What a blessing that is for us. It was true when this was written thousands of years ago. It remains true today. We serve an awesome God. I just pray that during these times, you will continue to know the grace and the peace and the might of our Heavenly Father. We have some changes coming our way. You've been hopefully reading my emails and getting some understanding of that. And next week, on June 7, we're going to have a reopening of sorts. We have been engaging this way. This is our 11th week doing these online services, and it's been a blessing. Thank you to all who have made this happen, but we're going to do a transition. Next week, June 7, we are planning to do a live stream. And so with that in mind, we're going to have it's just going to happen from our sanctuary. And so be ready for that. The live stream is coming. I want you to, again, read my email from last week, Wednesday, May 27. And just be aware of the protocols and the things that we have to abide by as we gather back together. One of the main things to be mindful of is having read the protocols and the things that were in that email is for you to make wise decisions and to use your personal choices and your convictions as you choose to participate or to stay home. We're going to be live streaming, so you won't miss a thing, but that's just how we've chosen to do it. And be aware of this. Our live stream is going to start at 9 a.m. because when we are done in the English service, the Hispanic congregation is, we're going to clean the whole sanctuary and get it ready for the Hispanic congregation to come in, and they're going to be starting at 11:30. So we're going back to back. So we're going to be starting at 9 a.m. next week. Make sure you're aware of that for the live stream. You're going to be required to sign up through our website. Our website is going to be able to, it has a tab there, and it's very simple. I've used it. If I can do it, you can as well. It's there for you to sign up, and we're going to be able to have the first 70 people be able to fill into our sanctuary. And let me just show you what the sanctuary looks like right now. It's kind of set up the way we're going to do it a week from today, and you can see we've got open spaces, and there will be chairs that will be not filled, but we can accommodate right around 70 people. So we're looking forward to who that will be and who will be joining us next week. Another announcement for us is that our congregational meeting is going to be moved to an online format and also an email format. We are not going to try to gather together for our congregational meeting this year. And so all members are going to receive communication from me this week. Again, our congregational meeting focuses on our elder nominations that will be presented to our congregation for approval, and a vote will take place in the near future, as well as our next year's budget, our 2021 budget. Those are the two items that are that we will be focused on. And so just follow the directions that my emails offer to you. And if you do not receive a communication on this regard, on congregational meeting and voting and such, and you are a member, then it's our fault, or we just need to touch base. So make sure that you connect with me if you're not finding out about these things. We want to get you involved in the process. If you have any questions about that you would like to present at a congregational meeting, having had the budget presented and our elders nominated to you, if you have any questions, just email me, and I will address them from the elder board as a response, and I'll send that out to everybody as if we were in a congregational meeting. I know it's unique, and I hope that this system works well for this year. I also want to say that our online giving has changed to a different platform. We were with PayPal. We've changed to an organization called Tithely, and you may give your if you choose to go online for your giving, just know that their fees are less. It's a Christian organization, and so we feel really good about joining a partnership with Tithely as a giving organization. We're going to have communion next week when we're together here, and if you're at home, then I want to encourage you to be ready to have your elements ready for that time. I look forward to doing communion again with all of you. It's time once again for our greeting. Would you just take a moment to try to just reach out to somebody and communicate with them that you're thinking about them, and we'll be back shortly for some prayer, and then worship and the word to be taught. hope you were blessed by that time of greeting. And let me just add to my announcements that if you are a regular attender of Palmdale Community Church, you consider this your church home, yet you're not yet a member, I want to encourage you to consider that. If I can help you in any way, let me know. We'd be pleased to have you join our fellowship. So it's on you, but let me know how I can serve you in that way. I was also reminded, as we are now anticipating being gathered together again soon and very soon, I was reminded of a little portion of Scripture in 2 John. It's at the end of the letter that John wrote to someone who he calls to the elect lady and her children. And it's a very brief little letter, but he concludes it with this statement. He says, "Though I have much to write to you, I would rather not use paper and ink. Instead, I hope to come to you and talk to you face to face so that our joy may be complete." And it's been a tough 11 weeks, I know, but things are opening up. I'm looking forward. I have much to say to you. And I'm looking forward to doing that face to face and to watch you engage with each other face to face and be done with this video presentation as our main tool of connection and just be able to go back to the way we used to do it. So I think I would agree that that would make our joy complete. So those are some thoughts I have. Will you join me in prayer as we enter into a time of worship as well? Dear Father in heaven, we come before you this day, grateful that you are our God, that you are high and mighty, that your throne is established forever. We agree with that. We praise you for that. We look forward now to joining in song, that our hearts would be filled with these truths, and that you would be blessed as we sing this to your holy throne. And for the name of Jesus Christ, for his glory, we pray. Amen.
Shall not want. strike wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous
guide me. Never failing, ruler of Thy goodness faileth never. Good Shepherd, may I sing your praise within your house forever. Within your house forever.
Hello, dear family. I'm pleased to open up God's word with you and for you today. We're going to be in 1 Peter chapter 5. It's going to be our jumping off point. We're going to go to various other passages. In fact, a lot of other passages. And as you know, one of my customs is if there's a passage that we're going to look at a little bit more length, with greater length, then I'm going to ask you to turn with me. And we're going to do a lot of turning with me today. Just want to set you up for that. 1 Peter chapter 5, some thoughts as I was preparing this. Again, God providentially allows me to grow and to learn as even week by week as I'm engaging with His Word. And I had an encounter this week that I'd like to share with you. I had an encounter this week with a young lady named Erica. She spent 2 days outside our office underneath the stairwell. And she was greatly troubled, so sad to see her there, dirty, unkempt, sleeping much of the day. And so sad, and there are many reasons for that, many of which I have no idea. I did not engage with her in conversation relative to counseling and all of that. We cared for her. We offered her some food and water and comfort as best we could. At the end of 2 days, she was in a position, in a condition where she needed to be taken to Palmdale Regional and actually, I believe, enter into the psych ward there. So sad for her to be engaged with her in that way also. But I'm not sure what her reasons are as to how she found herself there at age 25 or so, thereabouts, but I want to propose a suggested main reason as to why that was true. I am of the opinion, it's possible, that she was not led well as a child. That when she was a needy young girl, she did not receive training. She did not receive the care and the comfort that a child needs. Because a child is very needy. What do they know? What are they aware of? How do they prepare for the world that is coming at them? They don't even know what they don't know. And that is why the role of effective leadership cannot be underestimated. Devastating consequences abound for those who have not been led well. And I'm speaking of Erica, a troubled young lady at age 25. I'm thinking of many other situations, some of which are not of that nature. You would have a classroom that would have devastating consequences. You could have a community that could have devastating consequences, a home, a marriage. Applications abound where poor leadership happens or non-effective leadership is there, their consequences are devastating. And Peter, as we look at chapter 5, Peter, in the care of his people, in the care of his church, his flock, he has begun to touch on the topic of church leadership. He speaks of, in this passage, in this section of the chapter here, about elders and overseers and shepherds. I'd like to read the first 5 verses. They will be the focus of our study the next couple of weeks. But consider with me what Peter has written here, starting at verse 1. So, I exhort the elders among you, as a fellow elder and witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed, shepherd the flock of God that is among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you, not for shameful gain, but eagerly, not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. Likewise, you who are younger, be subject to the elders. Clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility toward one another, for God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. We'll be looking at these verses in the next couple of weeks. And I want to, again, just say that I'm so pleased to have the Word of God as the tool by which I can teach you, by which we can grow one another in the ways of God, because the Word of God addresses the human condition in all the various facets. It's one of the great blessings. And today we're going to just be spending a bit of time reading Scripture together as we set up this concept. I've titled my sermon, Shepherdology, The Study of Being a Shepherd, and we'll talk our way through that. I'd like to ask you to turn with me, first of all, to the prophet in the Old Testament named Ezekiel. Ezekiel is probably a little bit past halfway in your text. It follows Isaiah and Jeremiah. You'll find the prophet Ezekiel. I'd like to ask you to turn with me to the 8th chapter, and we're going to read some of these verses here. And again, you spend time this week reading whatever else is around it. We're going to be looking at chapter 8, 9, and 10, but some of the verses, not all of them. Read the whole section for yourself as you like. But what we're going to read here is we're going to read about the failure of the elders, the failure of those who are the leaders of the people in the Old Testament time. And again, devastating consequences are going to result. Let's take a look. I'm going to ask you to read with me chapter 8, starting at verse 7. Again, Ezekiel has been given a vision of what's going to occur, what is happening. Some would say that this is literal, it is exactly going to happen, or others would say it is symbolic of God's heart and of how he's going to treat and deal with his people and the leaders of the people. So either way, it is quite a passage. Let's start at verse 7. And he brought me to the entrance of the court. And when I looked, behold, there was a hole in the wall. And he said to me, Son of man, dig in the wall. So I dug in the wall, and behold, there was an entrance. And he said to me, Go in and see the vile abominations that they are committing here. So I went in and saw. And there, engraved on the wall all around, was every form of creeping thing and loathsome beasts and all the idols of the house of Israel. And before them stood 70 men of the elders of the house of Israel, with Jazaniah, the son of Saphan, standing among them. Each had his censer in his hand, and the smoke of his cloud of incense went up. And then he said to me, Son of man, have you seen what the elders of the house of Israel are doing in the dark, each in his room of pictures? For they say, The Lord does not see us. The Lord has forsaken the land. He said to me, You will see still greater abominations that they will commit. Continuing on, verse 14. Then he brought me to the entrance of the north gate of the house of the Lord. This is a reference to the temple. And behold, there sat women weeping for Tammuz. Then he said to me, Have you seen this, O son of man? You will see still greater abominations than these. And he brought me into the inner court of the house of the Lord. And behold, at the entrance of the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men with their backs to the temple of the Lord and their faces toward the east, worshiping the sun toward the east. Then he said to me, Have you seen this, O son of man? These are abominations to the Lord that is being recorded here. It's idolatry. Tammuz is a false god being worshiped here. There's also sun worship that is taking place as men are worshiping in the temple of God, facing east, and worshiping the sun. These are abominations. Chapter 9 goes on and speaks of some of the judgments that is a part of that. You can read forward here, starting in there in verse 5. And to the others he said in my hearing, Pass through the city after him and strike. Your eyes shall not spare, and you shall show no pity. Look at the devastation. Kill old men outright, young men and maidens, little children and women, but touch no one on whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary. So they began with the elders who were before the house. Literal, symbolic, does it matter? God is pouring out wrath on the people. And who did he start with? The elders, the leadership, the poor shepherds of the people. Chapter 10, verses 1 to 4. Then I looked, and behold, on the expanse that was over the heads of the cherubim, those are angels, over the heads of the cherubim, there appeared above them something like a sapphire, in appearance like a throne. And he said to the man clothed in linen, go in among the whirling wheels underneath the cherubim. Fill your hands with burning coals from between the cherubim and scatter them over the city. And he went in before my eyes. Again, Ezekiel speaking. Now the cherubim were standing on the south side of the house when the man went in, and a cloud filled the inner court. Again, a reference to the temple. And the glory of the Lord went up from the cherub to the threshold of the house, and the house was filled with the cloud, and the court was filled with the brightness of the glory of the Lord. Verse 18, skipping ahead, what happens? Then the glory of the Lord went out from the threshold of the house and stood over the cherubim. The glory of the Lord departs the temple. What an awful picture. A symbolic picture, a literal happening of what occurred for the Israelites to identify that God has left the temple. But why? Because of the idolatry that they have committed. And again, how so? Well, poor leadership. This is terrible. It gets worse. It gets more difficult to relate to. Turn forward a few chapters in the book of Ezekiel, the prophecy of Ezekiel, to chapter 34. And let me read for you the first 10 verses of Ezekiel 34. The word of the Lord came to me, Son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy and say to them, even to the shepherds, thus says the Lord God. Ah, shepherds of Israel, who have been feeding yourselves. Should not the shepherds feed the sheep? You eat the fat, you clothe yourselves with the wool, you slaughter the fat ones, but you do not feed the sheep. The weak you have not strengthened, the sick you have not healed, the injured you have not bound up, the strayed you have not brought back, the lost you have not sought, and with force and harshness you have ruled them. So they were scattered because there was no shepherd, and they became food for the wild beasts. My sheep were scattered. They wandered over all the mountains and on every high hill. My sheep were scattered over all the face of the earth with none to search or seek for them. Therefore, you shepherds, hear the word of the Lord. As I live, declares the Lord God, surely because my sheep have become a prey and my sheep have become food for all the wild beasts since there was no shepherd and because my shepherds have not searched for my sheep but the shepherds have fed themselves and have not fed my sheep, therefore, you shepherds, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God, behold, I am against the shepherds and I will require my sheep at their hand and put a stop to their feeding the sheep. No longer shall the shepherds feed themselves. I will rescue my sheep from their mouths, that they may not be food for them. What shame these shepherds have brought on themselves. And why? Because they were selfish, using their position to better themselves. Turn back with me to the prophet Jeremiah. Just before that, Lamentations, Jeremiah. Turn with me to Jeremiah chapter 23. Jeremiah 23, and I would just like to read the first four verses of this chapter. Again, this is another woe to the shepherds. And just so you know, the giving of the Ezekiel prophecy was during the time of great judgment that had begun to come and would be completed in the destruction of even the temple itself and the taking away of the people to captivity in Babylon. Why was all that happening? God identifies because the shepherds have been poor in their leadership and have led the people astray. Jeremiah in chapter 23, verse 1, "Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, declares the Lord. Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who care for my people, you have scattered my flock and have driven them away, and you have not attended to them. Behold, I will attend to you for your evil deeds, declares the Lord. Then I will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the countries where I have driven them, and I will bring them back to their fold, and they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will set shepherds over them who will care for them, and they shall fear no more, nor be dismayed, neither shall any be missing, declares the Lord." What a contrast. The judgment that will come on the people and the shepherds, but he is the promise, I will bring them back. I will bring them back, and I will establish shepherds for them who will care for them, who will not produce fear within them. What a blessing of what will yet come. 500 years later, Jesus has some words for the shepherds of the people at his time. Matthew chapter 5. In verse 20, in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is going to show his displeasure. He is very critical of the leaders of the people, what we know commonly as the scribes and the Pharisees, to use the gospel terminologies. Matthew 5 and verse 20 says, "For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." What he is saying there is that the scribes and the Pharisees are not of God. They do not have relationship with God. Their sins are not yet forgiven. In spite of all that they tried to do, all of their keeping of the list and presenting themselves as holy before the people, they are not leading the people well. They have not even found the way themselves yet unto the kingdom of heaven. And Jesus has said, they are not of God. Can you imagine what their leadership was like amongst the people? Jesus is very critical of them. How critical? Well, there's a passage I want you to turn with me also in Matthew chapter 23. Matthew 23, the whole chapter is known as the seven woes to the scribes and Pharisees. And each paragraph sets up with a woe because of what the scribes and Pharisees have done. It's going to be very difficult. It's a very critical passage. How does he set it up? I think we know. I think this is going to sound familiar to you again. Let's read from verse 1, Matthew 23 and verse 1. "Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, 'The scribes and Pharisees sit on Moses' seat. So practice and observe what they tell you, but not what they do. They are in the place of Moses, the lawgivers. And so do what they say to do, but don't do what they do. For they preach, but do not practice. They tie up heavy burdens, hard to bear, and lay them on people's shoulder, but they themselves are not willing to move them with their finger. They do all their deeds to be seen by others, for they make their phylacteries broad and their fringes long, and they love the place of honor at feasts and the best seats in the synagogues and greetings in the marketplace and being called rabbi by others. Oh, they love their position, but don't do what they do. Do what they say. They are speaking of Moses, but don't do what they do. They are hypocrites." And the seven woes that follow. I share these passages from the time of Jesus as well as the time of Ezekiel and Jeremiah to let you know that Peter knows these stories. Peter knows the scriptures. He knows of these Old Testament prophets, and he has developed a very healthy fear of God as he considers his leadership and the leadership of others. He is very much mindful of this. Peter was an eyewitness, very likely, to that Sermon on the Mount. He was there, maybe near Jesus, as he called out the scribes and the Pharisees with that judgment. And he was there to be an eyewitness to so much more. He was there when Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd." And he has watched it. He watched the proof of that for 3 years of Jesus doing his ministry, where he showed them that he truly was the good shepherd. Peter's co-pastor of the Jerusalem Community Church was a man named James. It is the brother of our Lord. James knows this teaching. James knows the power of leadership. That's why James in chapter 3 and verse 1, he said to his flock as well, he said, "Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness." I think we saw that in Ezekiel. Peter knows Paul's concern about leadership. Let me ask you to turn with me to Acts chapter 20. Acts chapter 20 is the words of Paul as he is going to be leaving the Ephesian church. He's continuing on with his ministry. He's been with the Ephesian church. He's now leaving them, and he has a word to the church. And this is found in Acts chapter 20, and I'm going to start at verse 25. Acts 20 and verse 25, it's Paul talking to the church, to the leadership of the church as well. And he says, "And now, behold, I know that none of you among whom I have gone about proclaiming the kingdom will see my face again. Therefore, I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all of you, for I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God." Peter is saying, "I've been a good shepherd. I told you everything. I'm not guilty of holding something back. I've led you. I've taught you. I've prepared you for success." But he now says, "Pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to care for the church of God, which he obtained with his own blood. I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves will arise men speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them." Paul declaring he was a good shepherd, but he's saying there's coming after me some bad shepherds who are about it for themselves, who are going to disrupt the flock. And Peter knows of Paul's concerns. He knows of these things that happen. Paul also goes on, if you turn with me to, I have these verses for you, into 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 12. Paul tells Timothy, "Let no one despise you for your youth, but set the believers an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, in purity." Timothy is being called to leadership, and this is how you lead, an example in speech, conduct, love, faith, purity. Be a good shepherd. He follows that up a couple verses later with verse 16, where he says, "Keep a close watch on yourself, Timothy, and on the teaching. Persist in this, for by so doing, you will save both yourself and your hearers." He's calling Timothy to be a good shepherd, a faithful overseer of the flock. Peter knows all of this, and Peter continues in his thinking, in sharing his awareness of leadership. In 2 Peter chapter 2, if you turn there with me, you may still be in 1 Peter 5, just turn the page probably. You come to 2 Peter chapter 2, and Peter is giving his warning. This whole chapter is a chapter about poor leadership and what might be coming, and his concern for the church as he will soon be passing from this life to the unto the Lord's presence. But he speaks in chapter 2, verses 1 to 3. "But false prophets also arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you, who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction." You see the devastation that happens from poor leadership? Verse 2, "And many will follow their sensuality, and because of them the way of truth will be blasphemed. And in their greed they will exploit you with false words. Their condemnation from long ago is not idle, and their destruction is not asleep." Follow over to verse 10. and especially those who indulge in the lust of defiling passion and despise authority. Poor leadership. Bold and willful, they do not tremble as they blaspheme the glorious ones, possibly a reference to angels. Verse 11, whereas angels, though greater in might and power, do not pronounce a blasphemy judgment against them before the Lord, but these, poor leaders, like irrational animals, creatures of instinct, born to be caught and destroyed, blaspheming about matters of which they are ignorant, will also be destroyed in their destruction. Suffering wrong as the wage for their wrongdoing, they count it a pleasure to revel in the daytime. They are blots and blemishes, reveling in their deceptions while they feast with you. They have eyes full of adultery, insatiable for sin. They entice unsteady souls. They have hearts trained in greed, accursed children. Sounds similar to Ezekiel. The devastation that they are bringing not only upon themselves, but what it will mean for the flock that they are supposed to be caring for. All of this Peter knows. And that is why, as he is sharing here again in 1 Peter, he is aware that some of the strongest warnings in the Bible are reserved for leaders who lead the sheep astray. And he is now going to speak to these leaders. He's going to remind them of what their calling is and how they are supposed to lead. Before I get to the passage itself, let me just give you three today. I mean, there could be several of these. I'd like to just share with you three what I'm calling biblical leadership principles. We can call these biblical shepherding principles. These are just a few of them, just some of them, but I think these will ring a bell. Would you not want to be led by someone who is characterized by these principles? Here's the first one. A biblical leader, a biblical shepherd, must model sacrifice, devotion, humility, inclusiveness, impartiality, compassion, mercy, and grace. That's what a Christian leader, a biblical leader, is supposed to be. Modeling those things, modeling sacrifice and devotion for the sheep. That would bear itself out in number two. Again, these blend together. A second principle is that a Christian leader, a Christian shepherd, a biblical shepherd, is not there to be served, but to serve. How can I serve you, says the biblical leader. It's not about me. And as we read these passages, you see the failure of the shepherds. It was all about them and how they can use their position to advance themselves in the here and now on the backs of the people instead of serving them. Another principle to always be mindful of, to have at the front of our minds as we think about leadership and how I might do it in a way that is pleasing unto the Lord. The third principle for today is always see yourself as an under-shepherd. That Jesus is the chief shepherd, and he has given me his flock, as Jesus said to Peter in the restoring of him in John chapter 21, how he said to him, tend my lambs, take care of my sheep. Jesus is the chief shepherd, but he has left, and he has left others here to care for the flock. Always see yourself as an under-shepherd. These are not our sheep. They're the Lord's sheep. He is the chief shepherd. Let me continue on with my introduction of all of this with some observations on leadership itself, just the concept of leadership, its place within our lives, our communities, our places of business and work and school, some leadership ideas, observations. The first one is this: we are prone to needing leadership. We are prone to need it, right? I'm going to speak more about this next week, but again, just the way in which the world comes at us, and as we grow from infants on into adulthood, there's so much that we don't need, that we don't know, and we need to have leaders helping us along the way. We need leaders. Secondly, we are commanded to follow our leaders, which is why it's such an important thing that the leaders be worthy to be followed. A third idea, it's a source of great strength and success. When leadership is done well and done right, it is a source of great confidence and joy for the people, and strength and advancement and growth and success that comes from it. And the flip side of that is a source of great failure and devastation. Great failure and devastation as well. That's a simple observation on leadership. A fifth one, there are those people who are excellent leaders. They have a way about them of attracting people and a way to communicate and a way to have people feel a certain way about them, but they could still be a false teacher. The question is, where are you leading the people who are following you? Where are you going? On what road are you traveling? What is the target at the end of it that you're driving toward? There are some phenomenal leaders who are going in the wrong direction and taking people on a path that will lead to destruction. We need to be mindful of that. My final observation for today is this. There are those leaders, again, excellent leaders, who draw from the people the thinking, the thought of, I would follow him, I would follow her to the ends of the earth. There's something about them that I desire to go with, to accomplish things with. May that be true of us as we grow in our leadership abilities. All of that to say, as we come to our passage, so I exhort the elders among you, and then verse 2, shepherd the flock of God. So the question can be asked, is Peter talking about church elders right now? All that's been said, all of these passages from the Old Testament, these experiences from the New Testament and the warnings and the judgments, are we basically only talking about church elders? Because that's what it said right there. I exhort the elders among you. And if we think that way, then the question could be asked, well, then what does this have to do with me? I'm not a church elder. I know there are but a few of us within this fellowship, a few within every fellowship around the world that has ever been within the Church of God. The number of percentage of elders is small. I understand that. So is this, though, only talking about them? And I want to suggest to you that you expand your understanding. I have not used the term elder so much. I've used the word shepherd. I've used the word leader in my explanation to you so far. And so I want to, for each of you, to consider, where in your life are you a shepherd? Where are you a leader of people of any age, in any circumstance? Are you a leader somewhere? Can you identify that leadership and just start identifying yourself also as a shepherd of those people? This is something I say, and I'm so pleased to say it. It's my great exhortation to men. Whether you are self-identified as a younger man or as an older man, however you see yourself, I say to you, seek to be an elder of a church. If you're 12 years old right now hearing me say these things, seek to be an elder of a church, that there would be a day, it will be years, decades away, possibly, but that you might seek to be qualified to be chosen as an elder of your church. If you were an older man, beyond 12, let's say, I encourage you, seek to be an elder of your church. It is possible that you will never be an elder of your church, but in the seeking, there is great strength for you. Let me give you an example from what it might mean to be an elder of a church. There are a couple listings within the New Testament as to what the qualifications are to be. Turn with me to Titus chapter 1. It's going to be a left-hand turn through James and Hebrews, and then you'll find Philemon and Titus. So I'm looking at Titus chapter 1. Titus has been given a command by his superior, by Paul, his leader, and he's been told, establish elders in the communities on the island of Crete. And as you do that, here's some of the qualifications by which you should identify them. I'm going to start at verse 7, Titus chapter 1 and verse 7, reading, for an overseer, you can identify that as an elder, a shepherd, an under-shepherd, for an overseer, as God's steward. Notice, these aren't your sheep. These are God's sheep. For an overseer, as God's steward, must be above reproach. He must not be arrogant or quick-tempered or a drunkard or violent or greedy for gain, but hospitable, a lover of good, self-controlled, upright, holy, and disciplined. He goes on. He must hold firm to the trustworthy word as taught, so that he may be able to give instruction in sound doctrine and also to rebuke those who contradict it. Imagine if the men of this church, young and old alike, were characterized by those things. If you never become an elder of the church at which you are worshiping at, imagine what those characteristics and those qualities and those commitments for decade upon decade upon decade, what that will mean to your home that you are the shepherd of, to your marriage, men, that you are the head of. Imagine the influence that you will have at work, at school, in your community, within the church itself, as you faithfully carry out the responsibilities that you have. Imagine the joy that will be yours knowing that you are following the obedience of the Lord, that you have picked up your cross daily and matured to this level of manhood. May I say, we have enough boys on the planet. We need more men, godly men, who are having an influence in their communities and in their homes. And if you never become an elder, can you imagine the respect that you would have of all godly people who can identify maturity when they see it, godly biblical maturity when they see it, you would have all of that. Men, I call you to maturity. I call you to seek the qualities of an elder in your life. For all of us, I want to encourage you to consider that you are a shepherd somewhere in your life. Whether you are a shepherdess, to use that term, Rachel, the wife of Isaac in the Old Testament, she was a shepherdess. But if you're not of a one who cares for sheep per se, but are you a father? Are you a mother? Are you a grandparent? Are you an aunt? Or an uncle? Are you an older sibling? Are you a babysitter? Are you someone who has oversight of people? Are you unto yourself older and wiser than someone else within the world, the people that you do life with? Are you older and wiser than someone? I think all of us at this point can say, I fit one of those. In that case, you are a leader. You are in the position of leadership, whether you are using it, doing it or not, that's yet to be determined possibly. But I call all of us to identify where we are a shepherd, where we are an overseer of people. And when you identify that, I just call you, I encourage you, care for those sheep. Care for them, serve them, love them, provide for them. They are very needy. Mature them into the ways of the Lord. There's a plaque that I have on my desk. It's on the wall right above my desk. I want to share it with you. It's something that motivates me. It was given to me many decades ago, and I've used it to keep me focused. I'm not sure if you can read it so well, but it says, be someone's hero. Be someone's hero. And this plaque is a motivation. It's something that is powerful to me. And I could ask you, whose hero are you? Who have you shepherded in such a way with such leadership and care and compassion and humility and service to them that they have identified you as their hero? Be someone's hero. There's a great need out there. I want to ask you once again to turn with me to Ezekiel chapter 22. You can find that again, about the middle of your Bible, a little bit more past, but after Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel. In Ezekiel chapter 22 is again a sobering passage Why does it have to be this way? Why is it this way that Ezekiel is speaking of? Ezekiel chapter 22, and I want to start at verse 23. Ezekiel is, imagine this word of the Lord coming to you, as it says here. The word of the Lord came to me, Ezekiel, reading verse 24. Son of man, say to her, you are a land that is not cleansed or rained upon in the day of indignation. The conspiracy of her prophets in her midst is like a roaring lion tearing the prey. They have devoured human lives. Again, the prophets of God, so to speak, those who are claiming prophet status, leadership status. They have taken treasure and precious things. They have made many widows in her midst. Her priests have done violence to my law and have profaned my holy things. They have made no distinction between the holy and the common, neither have they taught the difference between the unclean and the clean, and they have disregarded my Sabbaths so that I am profaned among them. Her princes in her midst are like wolves tearing the prey, shedding blood. So we have the prophets, the priests, now the princes, all different categories of leadership doing these things. Verse 27, her princes in her midst are like wolves tearing the prey, shedding blood, destroying lives to get dishonest gain. And her prophets have smeared whitewash for them, seeing false visions and divining lies, saying for them, saying, thus says the Lord, when the Lord has not spoken. The people of the land have practiced extortion and committed robbery. They have oppressed the poor and the needy and have extorted from the sojourner without justice. And I sought for a man among them who should build up the wall and stand in the breach before me for the land, that I should not destroy it. But I found none. Therefore, I have poured out my indignation upon them. I have consumed them with the fire of my wrath. I have returned their way upon their heads, declares the Lord. God will not be mocked. Leadership is vital, and leaders are to serve the people. And what Ezekiel is being told here is that is the rationale as to why God has begun the devastation of Israel, and the captives have already left, and the temple soon, Jerusalem itself, is soon going to be wiped out. And God is telling us why. I looked for someone to stand in the way and stand in the gap, and I found none. My thoughts again turn to Erica. She did not have good leadership, is my assumption. Pretty clear to see the vital role that leadership could have played in her life. Conclusion for today. I know that this has been heavy at times, but that's okay. We're to hear God's word and make our applications. And so as we move through this section of scripture for the next couple of weeks, as we go through 1 Peter chapter 5, that paragraph that I read for you, I want you to find a way to personalize the passage for you. Broaden out its understanding here as how you might be a shepherd of the flock of God that he has given to you. And ask God for the shepherding skills to do this well. And for a flock to do it, if you can't identify a flock, ask God for a flock. Find one. Get engaged that you might have a flock. Grandparents, community members, here at this church, children's ministries, find a flock. Maybe all you're doing is praying for a flock. You're shepherding them and caring for them and loving on them, and you don't even engage with them directly. You're praying for them. Ask God for a flock and ask God for the shepherding skills to do well by them. We could ask yourself this question. We could ask, Lord, who would you have me to shepherd? Lord, who would you have for me? If you already have a flock, you say, I'm full up. I know who it is. I'm full up. I've got that. I don't necessarily need more. I understand my flock. If you already have a flock, I encourage you to shepherd well. Do very well with that. And in so doing, as we've spoken of these other passages in 1 Peter, you're going to need the Holy Spirit's help. in the picking up of your cross daily, you need the Holy Spirit's help. In your sanctification and living holy, righteous lives, you're going to need the Holy Spirit's help. And in shepherding people, you're going to need the Holy Spirit's help. In methods that you can employ, in the way of thinking, having certain thought processes that captivate you, that guide you, that control you, and even in the character traits unto yourself. We've read some of them in Titus even today, that you're going to need the Holy Spirit's help to have all of these at your disposal. The best place, though, to go is to go to the Good Shepherd. Read the Gospels. Read the accounts of Jesus, how he dealt with people. He was perfect in his shepherding. He was the good shepherd, and he became the hero of millions. I'm going to pray for you in the shepherding process. Father in heaven, we are grateful for your words. They humble us at times. We understand your passion for your sheep and your people. And I pray you would help us all in all our areas of influence to be good leaders. I pray that there be no Erica's developed from within our leadership, that we will care and have love and service and compassion, that we will depend on the Holy Spirit to help us to be effective leaders. And we thank you for Jesus, not only the Savior of our souls, but the good shepherd, the example for us as to how to do all things well. I pray your blessings on the ministries and the people of Palmdale Community Church. For the glory of Christ, we pray. Amen.